Proverbs chapter 8, reading 1 to 4 and 22 to 31, and it can be found on page 640 in your pew Bibles. That's not wisdom call out, that's not understanding, raise her voice. At the highest point along the way where the paths meet, she takes her stand. Beside the gate leading into the city, at the entrance, she cries aloud, "To you, O people, I call out. I raise my voice for all mankind." Verse 22. The Lord brought me forth as the first of his works. Before his deeds of old, I was formed long ages ago, at the very beginning, when the world came to be. When there were no water depths, I was in the earth. When there were no springs overflowing with water. Before the mountains were settled in place, before the hills, I was in the earth. Before he made the world or its fields, or any of the dust of the earth, I was there when he set the heavens in place, when he marked out the horizon on the face of the deep, when he established the clouds above, and fixed securely the fountains of the deep, when he gave the sea its boundary so the water could not overstep his command, and when he marked out the foundations of the earth. Then I was constantly at his side. I was filled with delight day after day, rejoicing always in his presence, rejoicing in the whole world, and delighting in mankind. The second reading is Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5, and that can be found on page 1132. Justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into his grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our suffering, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Our final reading is John chapter 16, verses 12 to 15, which will be found on 1084. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. On his own, he will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me, because it is from me that you will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Calendar. We've been through Lent together. We've celebrated Easter as a community. Last week we remembered Pentecost. Pentecost, if you were there, you know that not at Pentecost, at church last week. Pentecost, this movement that Jesus Christ started, exploded into life on that day. 120 followers of Jesus were gathered together, and the Holy Spirit descended upon them, and thousands were added to the church in the following few days. And this week we're celebrating what's called Trinity Sunday. It's a day where we reflect on who is God that's going to continue to grow the church that exploded into life on that Pentecost day. What's the nature of the God that's going to sustain and inspire this church going forward? You may have noticed that Trinity wasn't in the However, you won't find that word at all. It's a new word the church came up with, and we get new words all the time in our culture. Before 2020, I don't think any of us used the phrase social distancing. Suddenly it became very, very important to us. There's lots of words that emerge from our culture. And we have a word that emerges from the church culture, a new word, this word, Trinity. And it was brought into sharp focus last week, because last week I went camping with my family, and we arrived at a campsite, and there was lots of camps, but no one else was there, it was just us. And then the next day, one family arrived, and they turned out to be a Jewish family, and they kept the Sabbath very strictly, and so we had lots of conversations. Our kids were about the same age, and the kids were playing, and my wife, Hannah, and I were chatting with the dad who was there, and we were discussing what we do in our faith practices. Family, but what made us different, apart from the food laws and the clothing laws, is this Trinity, that we have a Trinity, that we have this monotheistic, and we believe in one God, but also this one God has three parts. It's the Trinity that makes us different. We turn back to the reading, that Proverbs reading, we get the image of wisdom calling out. About wisdom this week, and I was wondering whether you think the same, that wisdom is a bit underrated sometimes. I don't think it's a modern thing that wisdom is underrated, but I think generally wisdom is underrated. I don't think people always say wisdom won't win you Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. You'll never win that on wisdom on that TV show. But wisdom in the Bible is to be truly valued. My friend gave me a really helpful definition of wisdom. He said, knowledge is knowing that tomato is a fruit. Wisdom is not putting it in a fruit salad. And philosophy is wondering if that makes ketchup a smoothie. But that's enough for my friend. But wisdom in the Old Testament is calling out. And the image that I had from that is a bit like a motorway sign flashing. Motorway signs, like a big arrow made of lights, alerting you to danger or to roadworks. And the wisdom is calling out. Wisdom in this passage is crying out at the gates, at the entrance, calling out to all humanity. And for me, that reminds me that the Trinity, the Christian image of the Trinity, is it's accessible, it's clear. The Trinity wants to be seen. God's wisdom wants to our hearts, and this wisdom raises the voice of all humanity. And it's interesting that in this passage, wisdom is a she. She cries out. And at times we do see some female images of God. In the Psalms, I think it is it's like a hen gathering up her chicks. And there are male and female images of God in the Bible. And of course, we look at Genesis. Adam and Eve were made in the image of God, so God must have a female image. And here we have this female image of God calling out, wisdom crying out. And if you read this Proverbs, you might see some echoes in the first chapter of John's Gospel. But in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. In John's Gospel it says, Jesus was with God in the beginning, and through Jesus all things were made. And this is an echo taken from this Proverbs reading. So maybe in Proverbs we have like an early vision of Jesus, an early vision of this. There isn't just one part of God, there's more to God. And I was struck by the last sort of sentence in the passage. It says, I was filled with delight day by day, rejoicing always in his presence. Rejoicing in his whole world and delighting in man's heart and humanity. And it struck me that there is no conflict in this Trinity. In this bond, in this union, in this Godhead, there is no friction, there's no conflict. There is complete working together. The Trinity constantly delights in one another. People talk about the Trinity being had the mother doting over a newborn baby. That is the image of the Trinity over us. And I believe that we need to make a daily claim in opposition to those who have children of God. We need to think of God as our mother and our father. I think it's important because if you know whose you are, then you know who you are. And I mentioned earlier, I've got young children. And when you have young children, you end up watching a few of the movies that they watch. And one of the movies they watch is Toy Story. Come to life when their owner Andy leaves the room and they have this dialogue. And there's a favourite toy called Woody, the cowboy. And then Andy, the son, the young boy, gets a new toy from Buzz Lightyear. And Woody is disappointed that Andy's got this new toy. And this Buzz Lightyear, he is convinced that he's not a toy. He's convinced that he is actually a space ranger sent from planet Thor. And he's come to defeat. Much of the first Toy Story movie is Woody trying to convince Buzz that he's not a toy. Time and time again, Woody's telling Buzz, you are a toy, you are a toy, you are not a space toy. There's a wonderful moment in the film when Woody said to tell Buzz to look underneath his foot. Underneath Buzz's foot is where the hand is. And he realised that he is a toy, he belongs. Time and time again in the Bible we see that the Trinity acts in unison. I believe that God called you here this morning. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit called you here. He's involved in every aspect of you being here this morning. The Trinity was involved in your coming to faith. I don't know how you came to faith. I presume that Jesus was part of that coming to faith. Maybe through learning about the life of Jesus, you saw an image of the love of God, and the Holy Spirit encouraged you to act upon it. And that's what you do. Because in every significant God moment in your life, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit have been fully faithful and involved. The Holy Spirit isn't restricted to amazing music, bright lights and huge crowds. The Holy Spirit, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, work in the quiet moments and much more loud moments. The Trinity brought you here. The Trinity will sustain and grow and deepen your faith. And if this morning you can say that Jesus is Lord, in your heart or out loud, then that's the Trinity. That is through the work of the Trinity. This in the reading from John, that everything that Jesus has is from God, and everything you know about Jesus is through the Holy Spirit. And John talks about this revelation being unfolding, God becoming clearer, but yet still a mystery. And in the Roman reading, we see the Trinity at work. We have peace with God. We are given the gift of the Holy Spirit, who pours God's love into our hearts. God called us, Jesus inspired us, and the Holy Spirit empowered us. That's our faith. That's our discipleship. And as earlier I talked about what brought you here this morning, I was thinking what brought me here this morning. What brought me here was actually quite a dull talk I heard. Go to a group called Crusaders, and we'd have some fun and games, and then we'd go to another room and hear a Bible talk. And often those talks would be quite boring, but we were given the Bible. And I got bored, so I just opened the Bible, and I noticed some of the words being read. I didn't understand why the words were read. So I start reading the red words first and down. Christ came the gospel. Peace to those who are far off, and peace to those who are near. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Thank you.
send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen. And you should have been given a letter sheet. And you came in, please feel free to stick it on your fridge to remind you what's going on. We've got a full week this week. Katie and Bill continue to be away this week, so keep them in your prayers. Just to remind you, we are continuing our Pentecost gift day towards landscaping the front and back gardens. We want to make the front of our church look beautiful and accessible to people who are experiencing wheelchairs. And we also want to improve the kitchen area and the restroom bathrooms as well, to be able to just keep up approaching the church and supporting the community. So if you'd like to give towards that, there are envelopes here. And also, the other thing is, on the 2nd of July, we are meeting our CMS missionaries. Together and sing 624, take my life and let it be.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. So go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.